job of programming, having the two dance classes right next to each other. Boston Ballet Harpist, Cynthia Price-Glynn. We are going to enable you to see music you all know and have probably played or will play. The harp cadences from Tchaikovsky's ballets, Sleeping Beauty, Swan Lake, and of course, the Nutcracker. But first, we need some history. The origins of European ballet go back to the 1500s in the royal courts of Europe, where stylized ballroom dancing, much like you learned from Nancy, was a necessary social skill for the elite classes at their parties. The parties were extravagant, with dancing, dining, and very lavish entertainment. In 1581 in France, Catherine de' Medici gave permission to her court musician to produce a very special project. The result was a 5.5-hour production that was total theater. Something we're used to now, but it was very new then. He told a story with a narrator, plus music, songs, scenery, costumes, special effects, and choreographed dancing that included pantomime, in which body movements and gestures were used to portray the dancers' emotions and actions. That event is considered the birth of ballet, a short definition of which is theatrical dance. Within 20 years, such extravaganzas were moved onto a stage with a proscenium arch, which made a clear delineation between performers and spectators, or an audience. The performers were still noble ladies and gentlemen, but eventually individual dancers were noticed and singled out and became known for their virtuosity and expressiveness. In 1661, Louis XIV in France founded the French Royal Academy of Dance to train and display professional quality dancers. And it seems that the school started seeking talented dancers from beyond the noble class at that time. Eventually, no narrators were needed in ballet because gestures and steps were created to clearly portray actions and emotions, and Sarah will demonstrate a few of those for us.
We still, to this day, if you go to see a big classical ballet by Boston Ballet or any ballet company, you'll see tons of these gestures being performed to convey emotion and tell the story. For example, still, a prince will stand on the stage alone and he'll say, "I swear, I love her." And still in the middle of grand scenes, one of which we will hear today, the Rose Adagio, the king says to Aurora, he says, "You are beautiful. You must marry." And then in other ballets, actually also later on in the Sleeping Beauty, Carabas, the evil character, says, "You will die." So we have hatred and love and just like a torrent of emotion happening through gestures and no words at all.
The costumes of the time evolved from fashions of the day, which were layered and heavily ornamented, etc., to historical costumes that were appropriate to the stories that were being told. And these became less and less cumbersome and constraining to allow and reveal increasingly more intricate and difficult dance steps and gestures. For example, as leg movements evolved, women's skirts got shorter and shorter, and the men's pants became less ornate and more clingy and lightweight.
This is actually a very modest outfit for today's standards in ballet. It's actually, the minimalism is growing. That's an oxymoron, but it doesn't matter. Costumes are getting smaller and smaller, and the idea is to strip naked the performance, quite literally. It ends up being just dancer and music, the harmony of which seen on the stage is all that you need to come away from a show entertained, is the idea.
I have a separate lecture concert on how ballet evolved from being a pleasurable entertainment for the European aristocracy, to a profound statement of artistic expression that resonated with the general populace, and how the harp and harpist were an important part of that evolution. But I'll be very brief today for our purposes. In the mid-1800s, the harp had become the instrument of choice for the aristocracy to hear and to learn to play in their salon gatherings. Included among those harpists were Marie Antoinette, Josephine Bonaparte, and even a visitor from America, Benjamin Franklin. The music was lovely, but of equal importance was the harp as a piece of artwork, lavishly decorated and a perfect prop to display the ladies' harpists' gowns and hairdos, as well as their elegant posture and graceful hand and arm movements. Today, we might consider it a form of chair dancing. As the harps evolved to being fully chromatic with hooks and levers and eventually pedals, they were more difficult to play. So eventually, the elite ladies and gentlemen turned to the newly developed pianoforte as their salon instrument of choice, which was easier to play than the harp. But professional harpers were still needed to play in the ballet orchestras, where the sound of our instrument was especially appropriate for several reasons. At the time, ballets told stories with fairy tale plots and ethereal characters like sylphs and willies and fairies, and harp music was a perfect accompaniment for them. As a result of this match, the harp became a natural and obvious choice to signal and accompany the entrance of the stars of the story, prima ballerinas, who would magically appear on stage to a magic harp cadenza. Plus, by the late 1800s, point shoes were used, so the women dancers could dance on the tips of their toes, which made them appear to be gliding like heavenly spirits, floating and moving effortlessly. Another perfect match for harp music. The music composed for ballet was often arranged and rearranged, resequenced, reorchestrated, rewritten, shortened, lengthened to the desires of the choreographer and the director. So ballet music is traditionally very flexible and adaptable. An example of that is the harp cadenza. There was a general formula to the cadenza, which Sarah will explain to you.
There's three main sections of a cadenza in classical ballet. The first is a character arriving on the scene. The whole cadenza itself is designed to sort of set up the audience for what's about to come. And the first section is a dancer enters the scene, their character shining forth to the audience. Then there's generally a sequence of movement. Either that character or a group of characters will move about the stage, expressing the music, expressing the cadenza, and finally resolve in a pattern or picture that sets the tone for the dancing that's about to come as soon as the orchestration joins. And today, Cynthia is going to play an excerpt from Don Quixote, during which Kitri, a fiery Spaniard, comes onto the scene in the third act. And I'm going to demonstrate that opening.
Ballet and professor of harp at the St. Petersburg Conservatory of Music where he is credited with the founding of the Russian School of Classical Harp Playing. He held all of those positions till his death in 1910 at the age of 75. And he left us many compositions and method books. The practice at the time was for ballet harpists to write their own inventions in collaboration with the choreographers and dancers. Many sources say that Szabo's harp cadences in the orchestra pit rival the dancers' virtuosic displays on stage. And balletomans often encouraged him with tumultuous ovations that would stop the show. Szabo was the harpist who premiered Tchaikovsky's ballets. Tchaikovsky was an established symphonic composer when he was attracted to the art form of ballet. The orchestra parts the ballet harpists receive today are Tchaikovsky's original cadenzas and harp parts. Certainly many are beautiful, but some sections are impossible because of too many notes in too many different directions and too fast a tempo. So harpists have to figure out how to make such parts playable. Arrangements of those sections have been passed down teacher to student and among harpist friends for generations. As a symphony composer, Tchaikovsky wrote out every note of the harp cadenzas. But Szabo was used to the tradition of composing his own cadenzas, so he rewrote Tchaikovsky's cadenzas. And legend has it that the dancers and the choreographers prefer Szabo's cadenzas, which are still performed in Russia and requested by many Russian ballet soloists when they appear as guests with other ballet companies such as Boston Ballet, which is how I became acquainted with them. So with that background, we're almost ready for show and tell about Tchaikovsky's ballet. But first, I've asked Sarah to talk about what the dancers need from musicians.
Well, there are three basic P's that are necessary for the perfect partnership between musician and dancer. The first is predictability. We are creatures of rehearsal, both of us. And we rehearse in the studio, sometimes to recorded music, but most of the time to piano. So we need the predictability that as soon as we arrive on the stage, the sound coming from the orchestra pit will be comparable to what we've been rehearsing. So a cadenza can no longer be a personal expression of music. It has to follow a predictable course that the dancers are used to. The second P is pulse, or pace. We're used to a specific amount of time to tell the story that needs to be told during a cadenza. For example, as I mentioned earlier, and we will talk about, in the Rose Adagio, there's a sequence of events that has to take place. Aurora has to see the queen, she has to see the king, she has to walk around, she has to look at people, she has to find out that she has to get married, she has to greet the princes, and she has to bow. And so, if the cadenza is played with passionate energy quickly, you have Aurora running around the stage, much like in Bye Bye Birdie when the conductor orchestrated it too quickly. So we need a standard pace, predictability, and the final element is phrasing. Dancers, we don't count the music the way a normal musician would count. We don't count 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1. We count very slowly so that certain notes and sounds in the music tell us, literally in my head, what step my body is supposed to perform. So I don't really hear numbers, I'm hearing steps and movements and phrases and peaks and valleys in the music. And we will demonstrate together the way, the difference in counting.
So this is a musician's count. I'm going to try three different ways, but I think you'll understand all of them.
what I actually hear in my head is run. I don't even hear a number at the end, so.
Okay, with that in mind, we will begin our show and tell with The Nutcracker, which was Tchaikovsky's second ballet, and I'm going to try to do some of the orchestra part too. It really messes me up, so. And Sarah will explain what is happening during that time.
So the dewdrop enters the stage. It's the end of all of the choreographed character pieces on stage. She has a moment by herself to enjoy the center of the stage, and she calls on the rest of the flowers. Where you can feel the Tchaikovsky version has more steps in it. There's more of an agitation in the beginning of footwork.
The third version is Zones, for whom we have to thank for changing this.
Thank you. Boston Ballet version, she makes her slow swan entrance. She does a signum and he almost gets her, but then he doesn't. And she goes to the floor. And she breathes. And then the potted up begins from there. And I can't do that.
Ready to
version, and they introduce themselves to Aurora. She then circles the stage and says, sure, I'll check them out and see what I think. Then she goes over to her mother and hugs her mother after that. So it's a different sequence of events that happens. Then the mother tells her to go dance, and she walks over to the center, and we have the same beginning. There. So the Kirov version has a different sequence of events to accompany the music that was played.
Well, a few years ago, I decided to revive the tradition of ballet harpists writing their own dances. And I recorded the Tchaikovsky version of Sleeping Beauty. I recorded the E. Walter Kuhn version, and then a new version by me that was sort of in between, but I thought it was stylistically correct. I gave a copy to the artistic director of Boston Ballet, Anne-Marie Holmes, who was staging a Boston Ballet production of Sleeping Beauty at the time, and she told me she liked parts of all three. So after several rounds of going back and forth and back and forth, we decided on a final version. And the cadenza became part of the storytelling of the ballet. And Sarah will describe his story. Do you want to set the scene?
Well, here, she's already greeted her mother and her father after arriving on the scene and the stage. And she's already greeted her mother and her father, and Cynthia, along with Anne-Marie, created a beautiful way for every prince to say hello to Aurora, who's standing with her father and mother waiting.
There are four princes.
You can hear it, it's beautiful. One prince takes his hat off. Another prince takes his hat off. Another prince takes his hat off. And the fourth prince takes his hat off. And they back up. And then Aurora comes and says hello to them. And now we have the instruction. You are beautiful. This has always been in the Boston Ballet. You must definitely marry. And she arrives. She runs around, takes in the whole scene, gets prepared to dance. And again, the king says, but I love the doffing of the hat that they created together, because you can hear that picture in the music. It's beautiful.
And you don't want to play it fast. You want to give their chance to strut their stuff. Now we have the opportunity to hear more from Sarah, if she could tell us about her perspective on mixing dance and music, as well as the difference between playing live music and recorded music.
Well, some of my favorite ballets, actually, I was thinking about this just this morning, but some of my favorite ballets feature the musical instrument on the stage. We did a beautiful ballet called Dark Elegies, beautiful dark, I suppose, ballet called Dark Elegies, a couple years ago, featuring the a cappella opera singer on the stage. Duo Concertante, I'm sorry, a ballet of George Balanchine's features a pianist on the stage, and they sit, and actually there's a moment where George Balanchine choreographed just the dancers sitting and listening to the piano music, and then they move and they dance together. And it's the most beautiful expression of just the way dance should be. We are always moving with music. Sometimes in modern ballet you're not, but it's part of us. It's what stirs us. It's what makes us dance. So that marriage is what gives the audience the experience that they're going to have. Just recently, just speaking to performing with live music, the company toured to Spain this past summer for 5 weeks, which was huge and awesome. And but we weren't able, of course, to pay for bringing our whole orchestra with us. I'm sorry. But we ended up performing to cassette tape, and one night, Mikko Nissinen, our artistic director, came backstage and said to us, he said, you guys really have to dance stronger you have to put more into it because it's really not reading because the music is recorded. And it was just such a, it like kind of hit you that that's such a huge part of what we're doing. Because the audience members aren't just coming to see what we're doing on the stage, they're coming to experience the vibrations of music as it courses through their system. Like, that's such a huge part of reaction in the audience to what's going on the stage. So I think that performing to live music is an invaluable thing. Like, it's why I dance, so.
And in the pit, we can actually sort of feel the vibrations from above. We don't really see it until they bow, and we can kind of walk out and go, oh, wow, look at those costumes, look at this. That's been going on the whole time, but somehow through the conductor, you feel the whole aliveness of it, which is exciting. And I've played for like silent movies before, and you're very locked in to what's happening. Where here's here, it's sort of organic, and oh, what's going to happen next? And ballet orchestras have to be really, really flexible because things can change on stage. So you have to watch really carefully. You might rehearse it, and you get the notes in the right place and things like that, but then you have to really be aware of where the conductor is taking you. You might insert and different dancers are dancing in different roles, different nights, and so the tempo can change, the cadences can change, they can be elongated or they can be short. So you have to really, really pay attention as a group and as individuals. But it's very exciting.
It's a big team.
Yes. Tchaikovsky's music is so strong that it stands on its own, like Prokofiev's Romeo and Juliet, and Stravinsky's Rite of Spring, and Petrushka, Copland's Rodeo, all of them were ballets. These are mainstays of symphonies now, but if you really, really want to know what the intentions of the composer were, you should see the original use of the music, which is how it is danced. And you can learn so much about the music from the movement that people put to it. Balanchine, the legendary artistic director of New York City Ballet used to say,
in ballet, you see the music and you hear the dance, which is all there is to it, basically.
You don't need to say anymore. We will take questions at the end, but remember this. With ballet, we get to time travel to different eras, different aesthetics that we hear and see and feel. It's wonderful that we don't forget or lose the music or dance of long ago. We recreate it, learn from it, build on it, re-experiencing what the music and dance sounded like, looked like, and felt like. And with each recreation of a classical ballet, the harpist and prima ballerina get to become sole partners for a few moments when the rest of the orchestra stops, the rest of the dancers pause, and an elegant ballerina appears on stage.
Specific evidence point. pointing to that, but I think simply because ballet is such a, it's almost like a cultural, it's passed down verbally from one situation to another, so that it totally makes sense that if there was a change in a musical element, there would be a change in the choreography, because a new team would be assembled, a new cultural group. I can't think of a word for it.
Perhaps my question was more such as chicken or egg.
Yeah.
You know, is it double showing off and then the choreographer coming in, or is it more of a partnership such as you described? I was just curious if you had come across anything that indicated one way or the other.
No, but the way that I did it with Anne-Marie Holmes seems to be a very natural way to do it, where you do work together. She'll listen and, well, I like that, do this, do that, or whatever, and then, what is happening on stage is this.
It would be interesting if Zalba was just like, well, that, and then they were like, oh, okay, we better change things. That would be interesting.
How popular was he?
Yeah.
Well, the dancers and choreographers really liked him a lot, from what I read, and probably because he accommodated what they wanted to do. Whereas Tchaikovsky's were just set. That's it. This is a cadenza.
Cynthia told me a story of a dancer who actually came to perform with Boston Ballet and brought their own cadenza. A dancer that, did I say that right? Did I say something right? Okay, good. She like brought her own cadenza with her. That would be like, I can't even imagine doing that. I'm in the corps of ballet, so I'm not a principal dancer, so I don't quite have that kind of like clout yet to handle, but I can't imagine going someplace and being like, okay, you'll play this and I'll do really well.
What was fun about it was that she gave it to me during the dress rehearsal. I guess supposing that every part was new to me. But it was what opened my eyes to the whole Zalba phenomenon. I knew nothing about that before. So I'm grateful to her, even though I was a bit panicky. Any other questions or comments? Are you?
I guess hot.
Oh. Yes.
So these are the true stories that you read in, you know, like a Harp column or something on the scary things, strange things that happen between the two. And for the harpist's sake, as you mentioned, ballerinas handing off the music, for future harpists up and coming, when you agree to pass on your favorites for the three of them, you know, at some point, do they then go armed to the teeth with all the different variations?
I think that's an excellent idea. I do suggest that you will be given the music, but practice it at different tempi, practice it at different emphasis, and sometimes they might say, play it longer, or we want more time, so you have to either play it slower or add more arpeggios, or play it faster, so, or we want less time, so either play it faster or cut out some of the arpeggios. And you have to realize that it's give up your ego, totally, and make music of whatever they ask. And sometimes people are not really good at that. They just kind of, I don't want to play this way. Look, and it sounds, I don't want to play this way. Instead of, okay, this is what I have to work with. It's not exactly, doesn't make a lot of sense musically, but you try to do it with the phrasing and things like that. And you can, you know, you can say things like, I know what you want, but let me try this instead. So become really acquainted with your instrument and what you can do with the dominant seventh chord, because that's what they are. It's a suspension before you get back to the dance. So it's a kind of improvisation around one chord. And then when they ask you to do something, sure, you've done it before, you don't panic. But the tempi are really important. Slow and make music of it. Play it really fast and make music of it. Any other? Yes, please.
You can tease us with little snippets. Could you play one whole thing?
Well,
like it's
go.
Flowers.
Well, we did, didn't we?
We played the full entrance.
You mean a full cadenza?
I don't know, whatever.
She means like the full waltz. sometimes dancers just like want to fall on the floor and just be like, no, gosh. But that particular waltz is, I've always loved, like the whole entire Waltz of the Flowers. I could listen to it any time of year and not get sick.
What's the part where the fairies?
At the beginning of the second act?
Probably.
I don't have my score with me.
There's different angels. There's different versions.
Right. Yeah. Okay, we have angels at the beginning. Are there fairies in the Nutcracker?
There's the sugar part.
Oh, oh, that's the sugar part, yeah. Oh, that's a play on the chiclet.
Oh, okay. You got out of that one.
Yeah, I got out of that one. Tchaikovsky had just discovered the celeste, and it was a brand new instrument, and he put it in the Nutcracker. Well, the ballet was not going to perform the Nutcracker ballet for like a month and a half, and someone else, another composer, had found the celeste. So quickly, Tchaikovsky put together the suite, the very first Nutcracker suite, so that he could use the celeste before the other guy did. Oh, the Snow Queen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, it's full orchestra.
Wow.
The harp has a few little things in there. I can't remember the key. Every once in a while, but it's not prominent. Let's say it's prominent. Oh, it's prominent in the... Thank you all for coming.